I take great pains to maintain my anonymity. I have multiple pseudonyms and multiple names in different countries around the world. I have access to multiple machines in multiple countries around the world. I have multiple email addresses. I have multiple social network accounts for every identity and every project or operation that I take part in. My name is Emery Cranston. I am 40 years old, and I am a hacktivist. I have been a hacktivist for approximately 15 years, and most recently I have become an agent of Telecomics.
Ο Emery Cranston, στη συνέντευξη που μας έδωσε, χρησιμοποίησε ένα από τα πολλά ψευδόνυμά του στους Telecomics. Οι Telecomics πρωτοεμφανίστηκαν πριν μερικά χρόνια ως ομάδα πολιτικής πίεσης στην Ευρωπαϊκή Ένωση. Σύντομα εγκατέλειψαν την πολιτική προπαγάνδα, θεωρώντας τη ανεπαρκή, και άρχισαν να προωθούν πιο άμεσες δράσεις μέσω του διαδικτύου.
I would say that Telecomics has at any given time between 500 and 1,000 agents, and there are probably another 9 or 10,000 other hacktivists around the world who are not agents of Telecomics, but either sympathize or assist however they can without necessarily making their identities known. There are agents of Telecomics who are also members of Anonymous, and there are members of Anonymous who are also agents of Telecomics. The meta-organization Anonymous specializes in direct action of a sometimes detrimental nature, and by that I mean distributed denial of service attacks, distributing misinformation, or compromising networks or websites. Telecomics is the other side of the coin in that they build new communications networks, they build new services that people can use to exchange information and organize, and they assist people in speaking their minds.
They're not as culturally rich as Anonymous, and they also don't have all the downsides Anonymous has.
They're more on the hacktivist side.
Yeah, they're more on the hacktivist side, and they're a little bit more willing to sign their names to things, which is, you know, good and bad.
The Egyptian people are living under inhumane conditions, being denied their basic rights to freedom of speech, freedom of religion, freedom of association, and the free access to information.
Τον Ιανουάριο του 2011, οι Anonymous και οι Telecomics αποφάσισαν να ενώσουν τις δυνάμεις τους, αρχικά στην Τινησία και μετά στην Αίγυπτο. Ήταν η περίοδος που η κυβέρνηση στο Κάιρο επιχειρούσε να κλείσει το ίντερνετ για να διακόψει την επικοινωνία των διαδηλωτών.
Telecomics was involved in helping to disseminate video footage and photographs taken by Egyptian protesters and putting them on the internet, when they had no other way of getting the word about what their government was doing.
The Tunisian attempts at censorship are doomed to failure if only we, Anonymous, the people, take up our individual responsibilities. For if only we decide to make it so, it will be done.
I actually think the most galvanizing moment of Anonymous, it was the beginning of the Freedom Ops. It begins with Optunisia.
To the Tunisian government, attacks on the freedom of speech and information of your citizens will not be tolerated. Any organization involved in censorship will be targeted. Attacks will not cease until the Tunisian government hears the claim of freedom from its own people.
In Tunisia, the government set up a phishing scam to try and get Facebook passwords from dissidents. And within a very short amount of time, programmers who were Anons had written a counterscript to it so that people could use it to prevent the government from getting their Facebook. It was a Firefox plugin.
So a lot of what they did in those situations was help break down the internet walls that those countries had put up to try to stop the demonstrators from organizing themselves. So bringing back internet service when the countries had firewalled off the network, had blocked certain websites like Twitter, for them to bring access to that back to allow these people to organize again and eventually to cause these governments to give up on their internet blockades. I mean, that's what they really did for the people.
To the Tunisian people, we stand together and united against this oppression. This is a battle which is waged not just for you alone, but to serve as a precedent and statement to the world. We unite to send a message that we, in fact, are not simply quiet citizens who can be peddled and choked into submission.
Amazingly, the Tunisian people, after so many decades, overthrew their despotic ruler, and the Anons went crazy. They were so happy. But within minutes, they were back into Egypt. How instrumental Anonymous was in Tunisia, I think will be hard to ever know for sure. How instrumental Tunisia was to Anonymous, immensely. There's a little arms race that goes on in these things too. They're currently very, very active around Syria, Bahrain, and Iran.
When we take on a monster like Assad in Syria, it's full-blown asymmetrical warfare, psychological warfare, cyber warfare, information warfare, and it will be multi-front. It will be an asymmetrical attack that will come from every direction at once.
Greetings to our friends around the world. We are Anonymous, the global resistance to tyranny. As you read this, Bashar al-Assad, president of Syria, wages a bloody and brutal war on his people who seek nothing more than self-expression in the face of oppression. The Syrian government actively controls the free flow of information for its own sinister motives through a complete international media blackout.
We have taken all of their cell phones, all the government cell phones of Syria are offline now because of us. All of the Syrian websites are offline, government websites. All of their communications are being interfered with and jammed, their telephones, their faxes, their emails. Anything that we can do, basically, any psychological operations, trying to terrify the government officials into defecting, information warfare, getting leaks from the databases of the Syrian government and then leaking information out, which we recently did with Assad's emails. And then we put people on the ground. We had a team of 15 people that were Anons and PLFers that were expatriate Syrians that we sent into Syria. And their only goal was to try to get journalists and reporters into Syria and into the Syrian safe houses in Damascus so that they could report. Unfortunately, that team 3 days ago was taken. We have no idea if they're alive or dead. The entire team was taken. All 15 of them were caught.
Ο Commander X, η ηγετική φυσιογνωμία των Ανώνυμος, αν και φυγάς και καταζητούμενος από το FBI, λέει ότι ο ίδιος και οι ομάδες τους συνεχίζουν τη δράση τους ενάντια στο καθεστώς της Δαμάσκου. Εξίσου ενεργός στις επιχειρήσεις των hackers στον αραβικό κόσμο είναι και ο Emeric Crimston των Telecomics.
I was one of the people who figured out not only that telecommunications surveillance equipment was deployed in the networks of the Syrian telecommunications infrastructure, but I also helped figure out what it was, who manufactured it, where it came from, and specifically what was being blocked by the Syrian government. Another way to put it was we discovered that the Syrian military was specifically stalking certain protesters, and then when they were on their way to a protest, telling them or calling them on their cell phone and saying, we know this is a fake cell phone. We have two people at your house. We know your mother, father, and your brother and sister are there. If you want to come back to them, come back right now.
Telecomics consists of hundreds, maybe thousands, of internet activists that work in the service of free communication. We use every communication technology that we master to try to keep the flow of information up. You are free to request anything from us. We do our best.
This is one of the tools that we've trained people to use. It's called Tor. It is a network which seeks to obscure the nature and the destination of traffic by sending it through volunteer nodes around the world. This is called GNU-PG. It is the encryption software that we train some activists to use. We train them in what it does, how it works, how to integrate it into what they do every day, how to use it safely, and how to use it to securely send email over networks that are likely under surveillance and cannot be trusted. And this is a tool that we were using when we were mapping networks called Shodan. And it is a search engine for searching scans of nodes all over the net. As the name suggests, it's everything from security cameras to the management interfaces of routers to the networks of power plants to iPhones connected to wireless networks. Actually, Shodan does all the scanning for us, and then it just presents it in the form of a search query. So, for example, one of the queries we did was, show us all the security cameras in Syria. So we pulled up a map of all of the internet-enabled security cameras in Syria in about 15 seconds. There are many reasons that governments fear the internet. One of them seems to be because the internet makes it easy for anyone in any country to get in touch with anyone in any other country. The internet poses a direct threat to falsehood and deception, especially when it is state-sponsored and disseminated falsehood and deception. The first thing that we're seeing all around the world is governments are trying to pass laws over and over again to make certain activities on the internet illegal.
Το 2011 παρουσιάζονται στην Αμερικανική Γερουσία και στη Βουλή των Αντιπροσώπων δύο νομοσχέδια που σχετίζονται με την προστασία της πνευματικής ιδιοκτησίας στο διαδίκτυο και την αντιμετώπιση των παραβατών. Σύμφωνα με τους εμπνευστές τους, το λεγόμενο SOPA στοχεύει στην πειρατεία στο ίντερνετ, ενώ το PIPA επιτρέπει στις αρχές και σε εταιρείες να διακόπτουν τη λειτουργία ιστοσελίδων αν έχουν αναρτήσει υλικό το οποίο παραβαίνει την νομοθεσία περί πνευματικής ιδιοκτησίας.
They got people really bent out of shape because they seemed very restrictive on the way content could be used on the internet. So for example, if you took a photograph out of a movie, like a screenshot out of a movie and posted that on your website, that would be illegal under those acts. If you took a 30-second clip of a television show and put that up on YouTube, that would be illegal under those acts. If you took a reference from an encyclopedia and stuck it on Wikipedia, that would be illegal under those acts.
The disturbing thing about all these acts, SOPA, PIPA, ACTA, TPP, are that one is the private, is the secrecy that's involved with them.
Από το 2008 και κάτω από άκρα μυστικότητα, μακριά από τον έλεγχο της Ευρωβουλής και των Εθνικών Κοινοβουλίων, κάποιοι συζητούσαν και σχεδίαζαν τη λεγόμενη ACTA. Πρόκειται για ένα νέο διεθνές νομικό πλαίσιο που στοχεύει στον καθορισμό διεθνών προτύπων για την πνευματική ιδιοκτησία. Παρούσες σε όλη τη διαδικασία ήταν οι ενδιαφερόμενες πολυεθνικές εταιρείες. Δισκογραφικές, κινηματογραφικές, φαρμακευτικές, εταιρείες του διαδικτύου και της κινητής τηλεφωνίας. Τελικά, Ευρωπαϊκή Ένωση, Ηνωμένες Πολιτείες, Μεξικό, Καναδάς, Νέα Ζηλανδία, Ελβετία, Κορέα, Σιγκαπούρη, Ιαπωνία και Αυστραλία θα υπογράψουν την ACTA τον Οκτώβριο του 2011.
I think that ACTA, SOPA, and PIPA were written by people who want to ensure that people think twice before using their fundamental right to speak their minds. It has become very obvious in the past couple of weeks that trying to couch these laws in terms of anti-piracy measures is a flimsy lie at best. A poorly worded lie at worst. To put it another way, I don't think that SOPA, PIPA, or ACTA have anything at all to do with piracy and everything to do with trying to quell dissent. And people are no longer taking their claims of piracy seriously.
Their advocates say that there are laws to protect intellectual property. These laws are supposed to be designed to shut down piracy and protect intellectual property. The fact of the matter is, though, it's government creating scarcity. It's government trying to protect one industry from its own folly. If the entertainment industry had properly embraced the internet to begin with, at the very beginning and dawn of the internet, and set up a business model that would allow them to function in this environment, we wouldn't be having this battle of pirates versus, you know, non-pirates, file sharers versus the law. That dichotomy would not even exist. But they chose to ignore it. They chose to take a militant and belligerent approach to file sharing. And they created this giant battle now, this giant contest. And they're going to lose because the reason they're losing money is they're putting out crap.
Μια από τις πλέον αμφιλεγόμενες διατάξεις της ACTA υποχρεώνει τις εταιρείες παροχής υπηρεσιών ίντερνετ να διακόπτουν και να απαγορεύουν την πρόσβαση σε ιστοσελίδες με πειρατικό περιεχόμενο. Επίσης, πρέπει να ελέγχουν τους πελάτες τους, τους απλούς χρήστες δηλαδή, αν χρησιμοποιούν υλικό και προγράμματα που αντιβαίνουν στην νομοθεσία περί πνευματικών δικαιωμάτων. Κορυφαίοι νομικοί και οργανώσεις ανθρωπίνων δικαιωμάτων υποστηρίζουν ότι κάτι τέτοιο ανοίγει τον ασκό του αιώλου.
So what that does is it creates an incentive for private policing. That's not how it works. If somebody breaks a law, whether it's a commercial law, which most intellectual property protection laws are commercial laws, or criminal law, it's the state that should be enforcing it. They shouldn't be going to internet service providers and saying, you surveil your users and you control their behavior.